Oh,
How's
how's
it
it going?
going?
I'm
I'm
good.
gonna try and position this thing.
It's good to see you again.
Great to be with you.
All right. Hi, I'm Jamil Smith, senior writer for Rolling Stone magazine, and today I spoke with Julian Castro, former presidential candidate and former housing and urban development secretary under President Barack Obama. We spoke about immigration policy, the coronavirus pandemic, and the killings of Ahmaud Arbery and Breonna Taylor, among other things. Stay tuned. It's a compelling conversation. Back in October, when we talked about the First Chance Act that you introduced, something you told me was really powerful. I thought you said, "I believe that so many people never get a first chance in life, much less a second chance." And at the time, you were talking about the incarcerated population, which right now, of course, is one of the most threatened populations during this coronavirus pandemic. Can you talk a little bit about the folks that you were really trying to target during your campaign for president and how they're suffering now?
My campaign put this spotlight. We centered the most vulnerable people in our society. We talked to people who are were living in a storm drainage tunnel that runs underneath the Las Vegas Strip, went to a jail in Washington, D.C. to hear directly from people who are incarcerated about how we should fix the criminal justice system, went over the border to Matamoros, Mexico, to talk to migrants who are caught up in Trump's Remain in Mexico policy, talked to folks who had been caught up in the foster care system and never really got a chance at getting good education and leading a good life. And I think about all of those people a lot now because, as many folks have seen, it is the most vulnerable among us who have been hurt the most during this coronavirus time period. And so I feel like, the message of my campaign was that if we can get America right for even the most vulnerable among us, then we're going to have broader prosperity for this country in the years to come. And I think that that's more resonant, that's more true today than ever before. I also see very clearly, and I bet that there are a lot of people who never thought of themselves as vulnerable, who have found out during this time period that actually they are. Just one missed paycheck away from facing eviction, lines and lines of families that had never been to a food bank before, waiting for food at the food bank, folks who are now without a job and don't know what they're going to do because the retail sector, service sector, so many other industries are hurting tremendously. So it has expanded, I think, the very notion of who is vulnerable, as well as making life even tougher on people who we knew already were.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that folks really are being acquainted with. I think you're right. It's this newfound sense of fragility, not just for themselves, but this country as a whole. I mean, within a week, we saw how America really just not fell apart necessarily, but we understood that, our economy was really living paycheck to paycheck. And frankly, we've seen how our government, our federal government, is managing things almost on purpose in such a very incompetent way. How do people regain faith in a government that can work when even we're seeing the CDC, the agency that's supposed to manage things like this correctly, miscount, as Reuters just reported, the numbers of infected in prisons and in other populations? How can Americans have faith in a federal government that works, which of course is something that the Democratic Party needs people to believe?
Don't get me started on all the things that we need to do better in the next administration than this one. I mean, you and I both know that that is a very long list, right?
Got
So,
time.
but let me take it, start off with sort of a bigger picture push. Think about the last 20 years. This is 2020. The last 20 years, 9/11, Hurricane Katrina, the Great Recession, and now a new, at least, recession, if not more than that, because of the coronavirus. I hope that in addition to finding leadership in the next administration, and I believe that we're going to have a new administration in January of 2021, but in addition to that change that I believe will help people to trust again, maybe more importantly for the long run, I hope that what people get out of this, as well as all of those things that I just mentioned, is that this Reagan era idea that smaller, weaker government is always better is bull. That we need government that is effective enough, that is competent enough, and that is robust enough to right all of those wrongs in terms of the inequalities and inequities in our society, and also just make sure that you and your family are safe during a pandemic like this, that you don't have to lose your job, that you don't have to go get in a line for a food bank, that you don't have to worry about this reopening because the government is going to have been prepared instead of unprepared, because it's going to have the resources to invest in universal health care, in universal affordable housing, in closing that digital divide as all of our kids try and do work online instead of in a classroom. If we can do those things, then I believe that we can actually have broader prosperity in our country that all of us can be proud of. And that's what I hope longer term, in addition to the leadership change we're going to have next January, that I believe will be an important step in regaining some trust. You know, if people think about the last 20 years, the problem has not been that we had a government that was too big and too effective and too competent. It was that in important moments, I'm thinking now especially of Hurricane Katrina and this coronavirus time period, we had a government that was incompetent, that was not up to the task, and that was not robust enough to actually solve the problem.
Obviously, the Democrats are putting forth, you know, relief plans in the House that, you know, the president has promised to veto. What other things are Democrats doing local, state, and federal level that, you know, you see are good things? What other things can they be doing better?
Well, I mean, look, compared to how Congress and the administration normally work, this has been like, you know, light speed, right? I mean, they've passed several pieces of legislation, made investments, the $1,200 check plus $500 per child that a lot of Americans are getting. Look, that is a good thing. There's also been about $12.5 billion that was originally invested in my old department, HUD, to address things like housing. Obviously, the PPP program, even though that has had a lot of flaws that have been well documented, and we need investment to get to those actual small businesses instead of a lot of the businesses that did get them. Having said that, there's a lot more that we can do. I'm thinking of the $100 billion proposal, for instance, for direct rental assistance. We got a lot of people out there who basically, when these eviction moratoriums run out in a lot of communities, they're going to get an eviction notice from their landlord. And what are we going to do to make sure that a lot of families are not out on the street or doubling up with relatives or sleeping in their car? I think about the needs that we have with the digital divide. And so many of our kids right now that are getting further and further behind because they're being assigned work to do online, but they don't have internet access at home. You know, that cuts across rural communities. It cuts across a lot of urban communities, black and brown communities. So we need to lay that foundation for broader prosperity, even as we take care of the immediate need. Finally, in addition to that, you know, some senators have proposed scaling up the amount of monthly investment that we give to each family, which, you know, I also think makes sense. $1,200 is not going to cut it for the vast majority of Americans. So we're going to need to do more than that.
Now, you mentioned housing, of course, which was, of course, you know, was the department that you were secretary in during the Obama administration. Obviously, you know, there's been movements on the left to cancel rent, rent forgiveness. Should this be something that, you know, Democrats, at least on state and local levels, should be pushing harder for?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, there is this certain feeling right now that all of the old rules are out the window, right? Mm-hmm. Because this is an utter emergency. There's an immediacy to this. And the most important thing is to make sure that everyday families out there are able to stay in their home right now. Now, look, it's also true, as people have pointed out, that most landlords out there, they don't own 50,000 units, 100,000 units, right? They have a single family residence that they rent out, or a duplex or a fourplex. That's a very good point. We can find ways, and local and state and the federal legislation find ways to make sure that they're taken care of as well, because ultimately they may have a note on a property. But here's the thing, it's actually going to be easier. It'll be easier for a landlord to deal with their bank on a note that they have on a property than for a resident, an individual tenant, to deal with a landlord oftentimes that is just going with a form letter, just going with an eviction process. And so I think that we can have that balance, but the priority needs to be making sure that families are not thrown to the curb and evicted in a couple of months.
A lot of folks have been emphasizing the census of late, Leon, and voting reforms. How important is that to, immediate concerns, let alone, going forth 2021 and, and going forward?
Well, all of these things tie in together. You know, what this administration has done is they've created a fear out there. Mm. They've created a fear among people who are in mixed status families that one person in the household may be undocumented. They've denied federal assistance in this legislation to people who are in mixed status families. Habitually, the census has undercounted people of color, including undocumented individuals. At the same time, there was just an analysis done in Texas that said, as of 2018, that undocumented immigrants actually contribute more in taxes than they take out in Texas. So, what I see out there is a lot of fear being created so that people will not fill out their census form, including, we talk a lot about the undocumented community, but look, the vast majority of people who are filling out the census are American citizens, right? But we've also had a habitual problem, a perennial problem with undercounting certain communities in this country of citizens. And what we need to make sure of is that the census continues to be well-funded, that it's a thorough count, and that there's confidence out there among folks that they can fill out that census form without fear that that information is going to be used for ICE to track anybody down or in the criminal justice system or any other way. People should spread that message because that is the law. That is true. Donald Trump is not above the law. That is the law that is going to be enforced.
What kind of specific challenges are you seeing for people who are documented or not in the San Antonio area where you are right now?
One that affects folks in this area is, of course, for mixed status families, the fact that legislation that passed, the CARES Act, said that basically if you're an American citizen but you're married to somebody who is undocumented, that you and your American citizen children cannot avail yourselves of the relief that every other American citizen can. That's a problem because you have a lot of mixed status families in an area like San Antonio. San Antonio traditionally has also been a more low-income big city than most big cities in our country. And about 5 weeks ago now, there was a photo that went viral. The photo was from a drone. It was an overhead shot looking down on a sea of cars. The sea of cars would remind you, if you looked at it, of a mall parking lot in the middle of the holiday shopping season, or like the 405 freeway or one of those big LA freeways when traffic is at a total standstill. Except this was a picture of thousands and thousands of cars lined up so that families could pick up bags of groceries at a flea market where the San Antonio Food Bank was distributing free food. So it tells you that there's a community there that is hurting. This is a town, like a lot of other towns, that is heavily reliant on the service sector in terms of its economy. It's been trying to diversify over the last few decades, and it has compared to 30 years ago, 40 years ago, but it's still based in the hospitality industry that has been very hard hit. It's still retail, it's still oil and gas. All of those industries have been very hard hit.
When you mentioned the service industry, I wanted to pivot to the rush for a lot of these states, including Texas, to return, quote unquote, to normal. Now, we can question, get into what that normal looks like. I think a lot about that because, you're wearing your Spurs cap. I mean, a lot of us need to get back to sports and think about, NBA season to resume. I love for, baseball to start, things like that. I'm all for that, but for it to do it safely and for people to be able to enjoy those activities, you know, when there is maybe a vaccine or viable treatment. But people are rushing back to quote unquote normal before there is any of that. And they're doing so at the risk of infecting themselves and certainly at the risk of infecting people who are in these service industries, people who are predominantly or disproportionately people of color. And so I wanted to ask you about that and just your views on this rush, particularly in Texas, for people to get back to work and to get back out into the world.
Look, it's understandable that people want to get out and about. They've been cooped up for several weeks. You know, they want to go out to a restaurant, have a meal with their family, or go have a drink with their friends at the bar. Obviously, people want to get back to work and make money. All of that is understandable, but we got to do it in a reasonable way, because if not, it's going to further endanger public health. You're more likely to see a resurgence, more cases, more deaths from the coronavirus. And also, you could be shooting yourself in the foot, so to speak, because basically you're going to plunge right into another crisis and you're going to hurt the economy even more. When Governor Abbott in Texas decided to reopen, Texas was 48th per capita in terms of the number of tests that were being conducted. And there was no real contact tracing program in place. And yet the state went forward with a number of reopenings. The state is still going forward, despite the fact that over the last week, we've had record highs in terms of new cases and also deaths. And we have certain hotspots in the state, whether it's El Paso or Amarillo, also meatpacking factories, nursing homes. So what I see is that this administration, this gubernatorial administration, Governor Abbott, the Attorney General, and so forth, really they're playing with fire. And they may get lucky, you know, they may get lucky and we don't see that resurgence, but that won't be because of what they've done. In fact, what they've done is put us in greater harm's way. I think you can say the same thing about places like Florida and Georgia. Georgia was caught fixing its numbers, basically. And I would not be surprised at all if some of these other governors or the administration underneath them has done the same thing.
Well, in fact, reports were emerging that the federal government was relying upon a report that essentially it engineered for itself, that they were unhappy with the projections of more and more deaths going forward in May and June. It's very strange, you know, to be put into this situation where the people who are supposed to be managing the crisis are instead seeming to be full on in business of managing this PR for themselves.
Well, you're right, Jamil. Of course, look, anytime you have a president himself who is so willing to be so untruthful, as well as a government bureaucracy that is sort of following along, afraid to make the king mad, so to speak. And so they help along with shading the numbers in a certain direction, you know, making it seem better than it is. It creates a big problem. It creates not only a problem of confidence, but it gives people a false sense of security. So that they're more likely to go out there to that restaurant or go have a drink with their friends or go to that event, not understanding the true danger that they and their family face when they do that. What do we do about that? That's why journalism is more important than it ever has been. This president's, assailing of journalists notwithstanding, it's why it's important that people listen to medical experts that they can trust and not politicians. And this should come easy to people, right? I mean, usually folks don't trust politicians in general, right? Frankly, of both parties. So, hey, you know what? Just this one time, as somebody who has been a politician, indulge that and don't listen to especially don't listen to Trump. Listen to the medical experts that are advising you and your family of how to remain as safe as possible. Because if you want to make sure that you avoid getting what can be a deadly virus, and especially, I say this as the parent of an 11-year-old girl and a 5-year-old son, all of us think first and foremost of our kids. We don't want them to be hurt. listen to the medical experts. That's the number one piece of advice I would have for people is do your research, look up what they're saying, you know, listen to the policymakers and the, especially Trump way, way, way back.
Just to pivot a little bit, what's it been like for you to be at home, to be with your kids? What have you been up to during this time?
You know, I mean, it's been a little bit weird because, I mean, this is a tragic time period for our country. It's unprecedented for our country. There's an anxiety, I think, that all of us share in different ways about what's happening because a lot of it is unknown. Right. We haven't faced it, at least since, you know, 1918. For me, the silver lining has been that I was on the road constantly over the last 14 months. I mean, I was running for president, and after I suspended my campaign on January 2nd, I endorsed Senator Warren, and I was on the road mostly for 2 months after that, and I didn't get to see my wife, Erica, and our kids. So the blessing of the last 2 months has been that I've gotten to spend a lot of time with them and, you know, just play with my kids and catch up with them and be a part of them doing their homework and watching TV and going to the park and all of the things that you want to get to do. But so many of us who are on the road all the time, or so many people are just busy, you know, working, you don't nearly get to do as much as you would like during normal times. That has been the blessing in disguise for me. And I've been enjoying that part of it.
Mm-hmm. Did you watch The Last Dance?
I did watch The Last Dance. I watched all of the episodes of The Last. Who didn't, right? I mean,
I had enough of Jordan.
I enjoyed it, but I wasn't a big Bulls fan. So, you have some of these folks out of Chicago, whether it's President Obama, or I saw David Axelrod, or a few other of that Chicago crowd that was super into all of that stuff, you know?
I imagine it would be a little bit strange as a Spurs fan to be trying to enjoy that, but yeah. Indulging in 10 episodes of Michael Jordan, it was a bar. It was a little too high for me as a Cleveland Cavaliers fan. But let's pivot back to the serious stuff. I want to ask you about voting. I know you're launching a PAC next Monday. It's focusing on revamping an effort to, elect progressive candidates. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
I got into public service, ran for office when I was 26 years old. And I have a soft spot in my heart for people that jump into politics early, and especially folks who have a progressive view of the world and want to work to make their communities better and their states and our country better. Before I ran for president, I was out there in the 2018 cycle supporting young progressive candidates throughout the country. And I'm going to do that again now that I have a little bit more time on my hands. I will always use my voice to make sure that good folks get elected at the local, state, and national level. And we're going to call it People First Future PAC. And the goal is going to be to make sure that the next generation of young progressives gets elected, young and some young at heart folks out there who have a wonderful vision for the future of our country, including taking forward, what we put out in the campaign of a People First agenda that says, if we're truly going to succeed as a country, then we can't leave out people that are always forgotten. We have to think about the most vulnerable, and we can make America work for them and for all of us, all of our families. I believe in that vision for the future of our country. And I think that this coronavirus time period shows that we need that kind of vision out there in policymakers all across the country. I look forward to helping make their election happen.
Now, are your efforts going to be national, or are you going to be focusing, more Southwest, more areas where you originated from?
Well, we're definitely going to focus a lot on Texas, for sure, in my home state. And I'm here in San Antonio right now, and I'm going to do what I can in Texas to help make sure we get a new senator, that John Cornyn is replaced. We have some competitive congressional districts. One of them is in my backyard, the 23rd Congressional District, that takes a piece of San Antonio that Gina Ortiz Jones is running for, and I believe she can win. She only lost by less than 1,000 votes last time, and the incumbent, Will Hurd, is not running this time. But I also am going to get out there nationally and support candidates across the board, because I think it's important to make sure that people are elected at every level, local, state, and federal. We see what's happening right now in Washington, D.C. We know that we need strong voices that are going to stand up for good policy and always keep in mind those communities that are hurting the most.
Now, obviously, voting is going to be a particular challenge this year with the pandemic possibly stretching into the fall and, you know, certainly creating a lot of angst or potential physical difficulties. What kind of challenges do you anticipate and how do you anticipate getting around them?
Already you see a fight around mail-in balloting. There's no reason why we should make people choose between risking their health and voting. We saw what happened in Wisconsin with that election for a Supreme Court justice in the Wisconsin Supreme Court. Right, the Wisconsin legislature that's dominated by Republicans in the middle of this pandemic said, no, you know what? You go out there and you stand in line in person and risk getting the coronavirus. And by the way, studies after that have shown that there were people who contracted the coronavirus because they had to go out there and participate in in-person voting. So universal mail-in balloting should be absolutely part of what we do in November. However, this also comes with some challenges. You and I know that low propensity voters, voters of color, lower income voters, oftentimes it takes knocking on their door, it takes a physical presence to get them to come out and vote. And what happened in California's 25th Congressional District special election a few days ago, I think can be a warning sign, as a red flag for Democrats, because what happened was that we didn't see quite as many folks on the Democratic base turn out in that election that was very impacted by this coronavirus, you know, time period. People didn't feel comfortable voting, or they were, you know, mostly mail-in balloting, right? So going forward, we're going to need to make sure that we're able to reach out to those voters that are lower propensity voters, but whose voice matters so much in this era when Donald Trump is targeting them and leaving them more behind and increasing the inequality in this country with these policies that only help well-to-do people and big corporations. You know, that's my concern, is we're going to need an all-hands-on-deck approach to get low-propensity voters that are the voters that need better policy the most out to vote.
I know that you have made a promise to support the Democratic nominee, like, you know, pretty much everybody else in the race, I believe. And but I understand that, you know, not made a formal declaration of endorsement for Joe Biden. I'm not going to ask you to do that now, but what I'm asking is, how, you know, can Joe Biden best use you to help him win the White House?
Yeah, I've made it very clear from the time I started running that no matter what, I will support the Democratic nominee. We need to defeat Donald Trump. And I'm going to do anything and everything that I'm asked to go out there and to help defeat Donald Trump in November. We simply can't afford another 4 years of this guy. So, you know, I'm willing to be as helpful as I can be. And from doing work here in Texas, which may well turn into a swing state, to places like Arizona and Nevada and Florida and a number of other states that are important this year, to the Electoral College numbers. There's been some good write-ups recently that Trump may have caused a realignment of our Electoral College that has made states like Arizona all that more important. There was a poll out today that said Joe Biden was 7 points ahead of Trump, 50-43. An Arizona pollster polling Arizona. Well, look, you know, there's momentum there and an opportunity to seize on. There's another poll out from Fox News that has Joe Biden up 46-43 in Florida. I think we need to make sure that everybody is out there doing everything that they can. And so, yeah, I look forward to hopefully soon a conversation with Vice President Biden and the opportunity to share with him that I'm ready to get out there and do anything that I can to help defeat Donald Trump.
Very good. I also wanted to ask you about DACA. That's been in the news, of course. There's a looming decision with the Supreme Court. It was expected, you know, earlier this week and didn't come down. What do you think that the court will do? What do you think that its implications will be?
There's a lot of anxiety out there. I mean, it's been said many times, but it's true. These are kids who, and they're not kids anymore. A lot of them are fully grown adults who have been in the United States since they were very young. They are Americans. That's, you know, how they feel in their heart. This is the country that they love. This is the only country that they really know. And so their whole future is riding on what happens with the Supreme Court. Of course, we don't know what's going to happen. We do know that we have generally a conservative Supreme Court, more conservative than it was a decade ago or two decades ago. But my hope is that they're going to uphold the constitutionality of DACA and allow these young people to remain as contributing members of our society. They're firefighters, they're frontline workers, they're teachers, they're folks in our military, they're people that are helping build stronger community throughout this country. If the Supreme Court strikes DACA down, it is going to be a grave mistake and a grave injury to this country. Because those young people, several hundred thousand, are a big part of a great promise of this country. And, you know, I applaud all of the different organizations, the legal organizations, whether it's MolDEF or the ACLU or others, the nonprofits, places like Catholic Charities, colleges and universities, a lot of which have gone out of their way to be supportive of these communities. I applaud them for doing their part, and I ask them to continue to be ready, no matter what the Supreme Court does, to ensure that those young people can stay here.
I want to ask you about what happened to Ahmaud Arbery and what happened to Breonna Taylor, and also, you know, other, you know, Black young people who have been killed recently, you know, Sean Bell, Nina Pop. You know, we've seen these violent deaths of young Black people resurface in the news in ways that we haven't really seen, I'd say, since the era of Ferguson and Trayvon Martin. And I think that they've done so in part because of that horrific video of Ahmaud's death, but also I think because our attention's a little bit focused, you know, in a different way. In this particular day and age, a lot of us are watching a lot more television. A lot of us are focused in, you know, on our phones in different ways. Can you tell me a little bit about first how you reacted to those deaths and what you have to say about them in the wake of learning that news, and how, you know, those deaths informed your thoughts on, frankly, citizenship, as we were just discussing?
Yeah, when the video of Ahmaud Arbery jogging down that street in Georgia and being murdered by that father and son in that town, when it came out, I didn't want to watch it. I think a lot of people didn't want to watch it. It was very, very hard to watch. But then in your mind, you know you have to watch it. And you also know that there's a lot more of that where that one came from, that incident came from, both in the civilian context of young Black men and young Black women being treated like that, and then also in the police context. Just today, they released video of Ahmaud Arbery from 2017 being stopped by police at a park because he was parked in his car alone at the park, just resting. It's one of these body cam videos where this police officer is harassing Ahmaud Arbery and asking him, you know, why are you alone in your car in the park, and he's telling him, you know, I work right over here and sit in the car. And then another officer gets there and tries to tase him. And the taser didn't work, thankfully. And then they just let him go. And this was 2017. And Jamil, you followed the campaign. Look, I'm very proud that during the campaign that we did not hold back in calling for reforms to policing in this country and calling for greater accountability. For whatever reason, this is too oftentimes a third rail issue, even for Democratic politicians who should know better, who should push for greater reforms. Because the experience of Ahmaud Arbery in that moment at the park being harassed by these two officers, and the experience of Breonna Taylor losing her life in her own home in Louisville, when the police had bungled an arrest warrant and have made up different stories about what they were doing and, you know, whether it was legitimate and so forth. And then all of the other video evidence that we see of police treating especially African Americans differently in this country, this is something that goes on every single day. And so, yes, in 2014, when we had Ferguson and we had the Black Lives Matter movement, politically in 2016, that was a much more present, you know, issue in the campaign. But I wanted to address it in 2020 because I knew that even though it's not in the news every day, this didn't go away. It's not going away.
Certainly not.
But here's the thing. We should make national change. We should have a national use of force standard. We should get rid of or severely curtail qualified immunity. We should hold local police departments accountable through a carrot and stick approach with Justice Department money on whether they adopt national use of force standard and report out statistics on everything from stops to decertification of police officers and other things to create more accountability. But to all of those politicians at the local level, you have an opportunity when you do police contracts to have a big impact on these things. What is your use of force standard? What are the policies surrounding de-escalation? Because it's been shown that if police departments implement certain de-escalation requirements for their officers and train very well that way, that what happened to many of these folks of being tased or even worse, being shot and killed, that's less likely to happen. How are you recruiting in the local police department? What does your police force look like? Are you not only recruiting people of color, but are you recruiting from people that grew up in these neighborhoods so that they're not afraid to go into those neighborhoods and they're not as quick to pull out their weapon on somebody because they think that somebody is dangerous in their head and they're acting both out of fear and I think oftentimes out of a lesser regard for that human life because of the color of the person's skin. You know, my message is to all of those city council members, to the mayors, you know, to people on police review boards, you have a lot of power in your hands too. And even if we don't get a federal, you know, solution on this, which frankly, I don't think is going to come anytime soon, you can still do something at the local level. And again, you can do something if you're a citizen out there, ask that city council candidate, well, what are you going to do about these things? How are you going to integrate better civil rights protections into your police contract? Make them think about it and then pressure them on it. Don't wait until the police contract is going to be negotiated and they're going to vote on it that, you know, that week. And then you're trying to, you know, catch up and redo terms and all that. Be proactive.
The trauma of this just compounds upon itself. I mean, you see, you know, Nina Pop, you know, the 10th transgender person killed in a violent act this year, at least, you know, by most counts. This young woman stabbed to death in Missouri, Sean Bell killed on a Facebook watch video in Indianapolis. It underscores what kind of country we're living in right now. And, you know, who is and is not judged to be protected under the law and what needs to be changed. And I just think that maybe this is this is really the time that where folks really need to be taking it onto themselves to change what needs to be changed.
Absolutely. And you know, there's a connection here. We have an election that's coming up in November. There are a lot of people up and down ballots from local city council races to state representative races to congressional races, senatorial races, and our presidential race. I hope that there's a tidal wave of support for candidates that are about doing the right thing when it comes to greater police accountability, when it comes to having a district attorney that is actually going to pursue holding police officers accountable, that is actually going to pursue people like those folks in Georgia that did that to Ahmaud Arbery. You know, that's the way in our country that if we're going to make change, it's our best tool, our best mechanism to make that change. And so, you know, this is unfortunate that we see these videos and what's happened. The thing is, though, like I was saying a few moments ago, it happens all the time. And these are very poignant and powerful reminders right before we have a chance to do something about it with elections that we have power. And I hope people will use it.
I think that's probably a good note to end on. Julian Castro, appreciate you taking time out of your family moments and your quarantine to join us here at Rolling Stone. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Hey, thanks a lot, Jamil. Good to be with you.
Good to see you.